So probability, again, I'm repeating, this is only for class 11th probability. It doesn't cover the complete JEE syllabus or for that matter, engineering entrance exam syllabus, because that would also include class 12th probability. So this is probability only meant for grade 11. Okay. Only meant for grade 11. Now, why I'm saying this is because after doing this chapter, you should not start attempting some JEE level, you know, past year questions on probability, thinking that now you are equipped enough to solve that question. You may not be able to solve many of the question, okay? Because the major chunk of this chapter comes in class 12. I have already discussed that with you. So in class 11th probability, we are mostly going to talk about these features. Okay, so I'll just give you what all we are going to cover. We are going to quickly talk about types of events. Okay, types of events basically, again, is a supporting concept for your class 12. In class 12, you'll come to hear a lot of technical terms like mutually exclusive, collectively exhaustive, and so on and so forth. So in 11th, we are preparing you so that you are used to those terms. Okay, so if you hear some strange terms coming out from my mouth with respect to probability, you should be aware that, oh, we have already done this in our class 11th. Okay. So in 12th, you'll be hearing a lot of technical terms with respect to types of events. So I'll be introducing you to these types of events in class 11th itself. The second and the major chunk of this chapter is the use of PNC, the use of PNC, permutation and combinations, in evaluating probability of an event. In evaluating probability of an event. Okay. What we call it as PE. Okay. So I hope everybody knows probability of an event is nothing but number of favorable events by the number of elements in the sample space, isn't it? This is the classical definition of probability. So this is the classical definition of probability. Correct? So in order to count the number of favorable events and the number of events in the sample space, you need to be good in your counting. And for that, you need to know your PNC very well. Okay. So when I was teaching PNC, I told you that this chapter is going to be very helpful in probability. Okay. And the time has come now that we start using the concepts of PNC. I hope most of you are well versed with it by now. We completed it last week, I believe. Okay. So good amount of practice has gone in, and we'll see how good you are prepared or how well you are prepared with PNC concepts in evaluating probability of an event by using the classical definition. Last but not the least, we are going to touch upon addition theorems of probability. Don't worry, these addition theorems are very much rhyming with your cardinal properties that you did in sets. Remember sets topic, the last part of the sets? NA union B is NA plus NB minus NA intersection B. So all those properties, they are going to come again in the addition theorems of probability. So we are going to revisit it. However, it will not take much of a time. So these are the three things that we need to address in class 11th probability. In 12th probability, we'll be talking about several other things like conditional probability in combination to multiplication theorems. We'll be talking about law of total probability. We'll be talking about independent events. We'll be talking about probability distribution functions. We'll be talking about the concept of Bayes' theorem, etc. So there are a lot of things. So let's wait for you to come in class 12. Then we'll start those concepts. Okay. Is this fine? Is the scope of the topic clear to you? Is the scope of the topic clear to everybody? Okay. So this is what we are going to do. Can be easily covered in one class itself. So let us talk about types of events as our first subtopic. Types of events. So what is an event? First, let me ask that to you. What's an event? Sir, birthday party, marriage ceremony, credit ceremony, they are events. Of course, they are cultural events, but when you talk about mathematics, events are outcomes from experiments. Okay. So first I will talk about experiments a bit. So experiments are of two types. So when we perform experiments, our experiments fall in two categories. One is a deterministic experiment. deterministic experiment. What is a deterministic experiment? Experiments whose outcome or whose outcomes, whatever is the case here, are well determined. Okay. Or it can be predicted with certainty. Or can be predicted with certainty. With certainty. Okay. So tell me an experiment whose outcome is known to you. Okay. So heating a water, you know, the temperature is going to rise. Okay. Putting dilute HCl to zinc granules, you know, hydrogen bubbles are going to evolve. Throwing a ball up, it has to come down. Of course, let's say I'm talking about the situation in normal cases, right? So these are some experiments whose outcomes are well determined, or you can say it can be predicted with certainty. Okay. Let's say, you know, you try to make fun of your teacher, then obviously, outcome will be you will be in your principal's office, right? Okay. So these are deterministic experiments. We'll talk about that, Arya. Okay. The next type of experiment, which is our concern area, are probabilistic experiments. Probabilistic experiments, also called as random experiments. Okay, random experiments. What are random experiments? Experiments whose outcome or outcomes cannot be predicted with certainty. Cannot be. You would be knowing total outcomes, but which of those outcomes will come, that cannot be predicted with certainty. Okay, that cannot be predicted with certainty. Okay, for example, when you roll a fair die, you know the outcomes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So these are the outcomes. You know, inme se hi koi aayega, right? 1 to 6, some number will turn up. But which number will turn up? That cannot be predicted with certainty. So this is a probabilistic experiment. So tossing a coin where head and tail both may come. I mean, you know the sample space, you know, either a head or a tail will come. But which one will come? We cannot predict with certainty. I'm talking about a fair coin, okay? Not a biased one. Okay, so let us talk about probabilistic experiments in our discussion of this chapter. We are not going to talk about deterministic experiments. So I'll be giving some example, like tossing a coin, tossing a fair coin, tossing a fair coin, rolling a fair die, rolling a fair die. Fair means it is not biased. Okay, not like fair. Fair and lovely, not that fair. Okay. Rolling a fair die. Okay. And experiments could be anything. I mean, many of us think experiments are like, you know, the ones which we perform in physics lab or chemistry lab or bio lab. Experiment may be as good as, you know, you taking a step forward or backward, right? Experiment. Okay. I'm walking. That's an experiment. I may walk forward or I may walk backward. So these are the two outcomes. Okay. So experiment could be as simplistic, as trivial as these. Okay. Now, let us talk about types of events which are associated with probabilistic experiment. Okay. Types of events for probabilistic experiment. Probabilistic experiment or random experiment. Okay. Few of them you already know, like Shor event. Okay, let's say I start with my Shor event. What's a Shor event? Shor event is that if you perform the experiment, that event will definitely occur. That is a Shor event. Okay, so does that make that experiment a deterministic experiment? Not really. Okay, so deterministic experiment, the particular outcome, right, is always sure to occur. So in a Shor event is a special case where if you perform it in a probabilistic experiment also, that outcome is definitely going to occur. For example, getting a number lesser than equal to 6 or getting a natural number lesser than equal to 6 when you roll a die, that's a Shor event. It will occur. Any number that occur has to be lesser than or equal to 6 when you roll a die. Correct? Can you give me few more examples where an event resulting from a probabilistic experiment is a sure event? Any example that comes in your mind? Don't give the same example which I gave right now. Think. Nobody. Okay, so very good example given by Harshita. She says that there is a box full of red balls. You're trying to pick a ball from it. What is the probability of getting a red ball? Of course, if the box is full of red balls, any ball you pick up would be a red ball. So this is a sure event. Very good example. Anybody else who would like to add to that example? Okay. So please think of some examples and do let me know. So in short, probability of a sure event will always be equal to 1. Okay. In general, we already know this. I'm not repeating this. There are a lot of things you have already learned in your class 9th and 10th. In general, probability of any event lies between 0 to 1. Okay. Now talking about 0, 0 is basically the probability of an impossible event. Impossible event. So an event whose probability of occurrence is 0, that means that event is impossible to occur. Let's say the same example which Harshita gave. What is the probability of picking a red ball from a box which is full of, let's say, green balls? Right? You cannot get a red ball, right? So that probability would be 0. Yes or no? What is the probability of you getting a number greater than 6 when you roll a die? 0. It cannot occur. Okay, so these are impossible events. You are already aware of it, so I will not be spending time on these. Rather, let's start talking about something slightly serious. Mutually exclusive events. Mutually exclusive events. Okay, let's try to understand this. Events A and B are said to be mutually exclusive. Exclusive. If or when they cannot occur together, that means their intersection is a null set. Their intersection is a null set, means they cannot occur together. So these two events cannot occur at the same time. Okay. In the language of probability, we say for such an event, the probability of occurrence of A and B is going to be 0. That means it will be an impossible event of both of them occurring together. For example, I can give you several examples here. In fact, you will also give me some examples. I will start with the first example. Let's say getting 1 and 6 on the top face of a die. Okay, let's say a die is rolled. So getting 1 is, let's say, event A. Getting a 6 is, let's say, event B. So you getting both the numbers on the top face of a fair die, is it possible? No, they cannot occur together. So these events are mutually exclusive, right? Getting head and tail both when you toss a coin, mutually exclusive, cannot occur together, right? Can you give me another example? Getting an even number and odd number on rolling a die. On rolling a fair die. Again, mutually exclusive. You can't get an even and odds. A number cannot be simultaneously an even and odd both. Okay. Yes. It raining and not raining. Okay. By the way, let's not get confused with mutually exclusive and complementary. Okay. So right now, the example which I gave you in the second one, these two events are complementary also. But the first example, 1 and 6 are not complementary, but they are mutually exclusive. We will come to that. Don't worry about what is complementary. First, let us focus on. So yes, raining, not raining is absolutely mutually exclusive events. Very right, Achintya. Drawing a number 15 from a deck of cards is an impossible event. You have to tell me two events which cannot occur together. One event is not mutually exclusive. Mutually, the word mutually comes when there are two people, right? Mutually, more than two, two or more than two. So tell me two events which cannot occur together. Okay, that's fine. Any other example? Okay, I'll give you some examples in terms of numbers. So let's say you roll a die. Okay, event A is where you ended up getting 1, 2, 3, 4. Event B is where you ended up getting 5, 6. Okay, are these two events mutually exclusive? Yes, because you will say, sir, there is nothing in common between them. That means the probability of A and B is going to be zero. That means both event A and B cannot occur together because they don't have anything in common. Is it fine? Yes. Days of a week. If you pick up 2 days of a week, and let's say one day is a Sunday, another day is a Monday, right? Sunday and Monday, one day cannot be both of them. It has to be one of them. So they are mutually exclusive. Okay. So in short and simple words, let me conclude this concept of mutually exclusive. If two events do not occur together or cannot occur together, they are called mutually exclusive. That means their intersection is disjoint. A intersection B is a null set. That means A and B are disjoint sets. Okay. So probability of two mutually exclusive events is of occurrence of two mutually exclusive events is always a zero. Is it fine? Any questions? We'll come back with more questions based on this after I am done with all the types of events. So now let us go to the next part, which is independent events. See, these words or these names look very, very similar, very, very rhyming to each other, but there is a lot of difference between them. Okay. What are mutually exclusive? Sorry. What are independent events? So event A and B are said to be independent events. Independent events. When occurrence or non-occurrence, both are applicable. When occurrence or non-occurrence of one does not influence or affect the occurrence or non-occurrence of the other. Okay. A simple example that I can cite over here is that, let's say you are rolling a die. Okay. And let's say A is the event that you get a six. Get a six on a fair die. And you are tossing a coin and you get heads. Okay. On a fair coin, on tossing a fair coin. Okay. Now, if I ask you that if you roll, let's say there is an experiment where you are doing both the activities, you are rolling a die, you are tossing a coin. Okay. What is the probability of occurrence of a head on the coin and occurrence of a six on the fair die? What will your answer be? In such cases, you will say, it is as good as you get a head on the coin and you get a six on the die. That means half into 1/6, that is 1/12, right? So any two events which satisfy this criteria, they will be called as independent events. Okay, pardon the slip of tongue that I had. So it is called independent events. So any two events which satisfy this criteria. So many people ask me, sir, what if there are three events? What is the condition for three events to be independent? Same thing. You just have to extend it to you know, three events, like saying PA intersection B intersection C is equal to PA into PB into PC. When such a thing is happening for an experiment or events associated with an experiment, those events would be called as independent events. Are you getting my point? So tossing a coin, let's say you're tossing a coin and rolling a die, you getting a head and you getting a six, of course, on the coin and the die respectively, they will be independent events. It is not that if you get a six on the die, it will affect you getting the head on the coin. Will it affect? No, right? And vice versa also. If you get a head on the coin, it will not affect you getting a six on the die, isn't it? Now, many a times by reading the question also, you can come to know that these events are independent. That means they are, you know, they're not affecting each other outcome. Okay. But many a times, I mean, in higher versions of independent event questions, which you will do in class 12, by reading the question, it is not very obvious many a times that the two events are independent or not. For that, you need to rely on this formula. Okay. But don't worry too much about it right now. In 11th, you will not be bothered with independent events concepts. It is a subject matter of class 12th. Okay. So next year, almost at the same time, we'll be talking about independent events questions. Okay. Is this fine? Any questions? Any questions? So do not treat independent events and mutually exclusive events to be the same thing. Mutually exclusive events do not occur together. Independent events, they occur together, but one will not influence the occurrence of the other. Okay. Unless until, I know one of them is an impossible event. So we cannot, please be careful with the use of the word mutually exclusive and independent. I have seen people in class 11th using them one for the other. No, they are quite different from each other. Next is exhaustive events. Or sometimes people call it as collectively exhaustive events. Exhaustive events or collectively exhaustive events. So what are collectively exhaustive events? So let's say we have E1, E2, E3, da-da-da-da-da till EN. Let's say these events are collectively exhaustive. When their union is basically your sample space. Okay. When this union becomes your sample space. Okay. That is to say, the probability of union of these events will definitely be one, because probability of a sample space is always one. Okay. So events E1, E2, E3, da 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 till EN are collectively exhaustive when their union is the sample space. For example, let us say you are rolling a die. Okay. Set A is the event where you ended up getting 1, 3. Set B is the event where you ended up getting 5, 6. And set C is the event where you ended up getting a 2, 4. Now, in fact, I can say 1, 2, 4 also. Okay. It need not be all disjoint. Let me put 3 here also. Okay. Now, if I ask you this question, are these three events collectively exhaustive events? What will you check? You will check their union. Are their unions giving me the entire sample space? Which I think so, it is. Correct? So this is your sample space. So if this is happening, you will say, yes, these events are, that is your A, B, C events are collectively exhaustive. Are collectively exhaustive. Is it fine? So if somebody asks you to check whether three events are collectively exhaustive or not, just see whether their union makes the entire sample space. Whether the union makes the entire sample space. Is it fine? Any question with respect to collectively exhaustive? So can I say Events can be, these events could be mutually, these events can be collectively exhaustive, like you getting odd number and you getting even number when you roll a die. Correct? Collectively exhaustive because the union will make the sample space. Head, tail, they are also collectively exhaustive. Okay? Because either you get a head or you get a tail, that means the union will be your sample space. Okay? So these all could be examples of collectively exhaustive events. Now, MCQ answers, yes, all possible MCQ answers, of course, you know, they can, if let's say there are multiple options, correct also, they are collectively exhaustive. Correct, Arvind. Now, let me have now a combination of these two types. So I will now introduce you to the sixth type of event, which is mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive. This is one of the most commonly seen type of event in class 12th also. Mutually exclusive, and collectively exhaustive. Okay. So let me give it an abbreviation, M-E-C-E, MECE. Okay, so I'll be using this word very commonly in class 12. I'll say these are MECE events, okay? So MECE means mutually exclusive, but collectively exhaustive. Okay, so let me first define it. Satyam has a question. This is, sir, so this is the tossing of coin example and getting either a head or tail. Oh, you're talking about this case, mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive? Yes, you are absolutely right, Satyam. You getting a head and a tail, they are mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive. Very, very, very nice example he has given. Okay. So let me formally write it in mathematical jargon, not for the purpose of confusing you, but making the idea clear. So these events are said to be MECE, when these two criteria are met. Number one criteria, if you take any two of them, they are disjoint. Achha, by the way, if out of E1, E2, E3 till EN, if any two of them are disjoint, will any three of them will be disjoint? Yes or no? I'm asking you a very stupid question, but still I want to see whether. If any two are disjoint, can I say any three of them will also be disjoint? Of course, yes. Nothing to think. And their union. Okay, let me write in terms of symbols. And their union would be a sample space. So the two words, mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive, I made the two criteria out of it. So events E1, E2, E3 till EN are said to be mutually exclusive when, if you take any two of them, they cannot occur together. Okay. But the union of all these events make the sample space. Okay. A very interesting example that I can cite for this is, again, getting an even number when you roll a die and getting an odd number when you roll a die. They're mutually exclusive because they can't occur together. But at the same time, they're collectively exhaustive because together they make the entire sample space. Okay. Now, a special case under this is your complementary events. So let me name it as number 7. Complementary events. Okay. Now, why I call this as a special case, let me explain this to you. Events E and E dash are said to be complementary. Complementary when they are MECE. So if two events are mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive, that means E intersection E complement is a null set. That is to say, P of E intersection E complement is zero, but at the same time, their union is the sample space. That is to say that P, E union, E complement is one. Then the event E1 and E, sorry, E and E dash. Okay. I purposely put a bar on the top of it. I could have called it as E1, E2 also, but I wanted to give them a special identification. So I called them as E and E dash, the same way as we do it in our sets chapter. Remember, complement of a set. I think I still remember some of you had a hard time understanding it. So E and E dash are said to be complementary events when simultaneously these two criteria are satisfied. Now, a typical example of this is your head and a tail. Okay. So head and tail cannot occur together, and union of them is the sample space. So getting a head and getting a tail are complementary events. Only two events are complementary. You cannot say three events are complementary to each other. No. Complementary means opposite, raining or not raining, complementary events, because they cannot occur together. And either it will rain or it will not rain, right? The union is the sample space. There is no third situation, isn't it? Now, many people ask me, sir, can you give an example to clearly distinguish between complementary and MECE? So complementary are special types of MECE events. Try to understand here. Special types of MECE. So let's say I have an event like this. Okay, I'll give an example for this. Let's say you roll a die. You get 1, 2. You get 3, 4. You get 4, 5, 6. Okay. You can see here that any two of them, if you take, you will get a null set. Intersection is a null set, isn't it? You take A, B intersection. You take A, C intersection. You take B, C intersection. And if you take their union, you will end up getting the sample space. So these are examples of MECE events. Correct. But you cannot say they are complementary events. No, complementary is only applied to two events, not three, or not to more than two, so as to say. Are you getting my point? So can I say here A and B are complementary? Can I say that? Can I say A and B are complementary? No, I cannot say. They are mutually exclusive. But they are not collectively exhaustive. If you do A union B, will you get all the outcomes when you roll a die? No, right? Right? So A and B, you cannot say they are complementary events. You can say they are mutually exclusive events. Similarly, B and C, you can say they are mutually exclusive. Similarly, A and C, you can say they are mutually exclusive. Right? But if I take an example like this, A is 1, 2, 3, 4, and B is 5, 6. Then can I say A and B are complementary events? Can I say this? Can I say these are complementary events? Yes or no? Yes or no? Yes or no? Correct? Because they satisfy both the criteria that their intersection is a null set and their union is the sample space. So A and B becomes complementary. So if you want, you can write B as A bar or A as B bar. Do you get the difference between the two now? Right? In case, let's say you attend an KVPY interview. We never know. It may happen. Let's say you're writing it in 12th and the professor wants to know, hey, what's the difference between complementary events and mutually exclusive, collectively exhaustive events? You should be very, very clear with your understanding. How is their union a sample space? Arya, I believe that the union will give everything which is going to come out from rolling of a die. Am I making any error in that? Don't say sorry, say IU. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions related to whatever we have done, all the seven types of events? Okay, now something very interesting I would like to tell you beforehand, even though we are officially going to talk about it. When two events are complementary, okay, something very interesting links their probabilities. This is always true. This is always true for two events which are complementary. Now, many of you would be wondering, how do I get this formula? How did Sir get this expression? See, later on, many of you have not done this chapter in school. Am I right? What am I saying? Many of you, all of you have not done this chapter in school, right? I forgot you all belong to the same school. Have you done this chapter in school? Somebody please confirm. No. Okay. So you have not done. Okay. No problem. So you will learn a little later on that there is a special addition theorem, very similar to what you have learned in your sets chapter. Sorry. PA union B is PA plus PB minus PA intersection B. Okay. Yes, this is going to come up a little later on. We'll talk about it a little later on. In light of this, if I introduce A and B as E and E complement. Okay, let's say A is E and B is E complement. So can I say, as per this formula, which as of now you have to assume it to be true. Okay. Okay, I get this. Now, if E and E dash are complementary, their union is the sample space, right? So probability of a sample space is always a one. Correct. So this left hand side will become a one. This is PE. This is PE bar. And when two events are complementary, their intersection is a null set. That means their probability of occurrence is zero. Correct. In light of this, can I not conclude that PE plus PE bar is going to be always a one? Okay. Hence the result. Okay. That is to say, PE or PE bar is one minus PE. Okay, this is something which you will be using very, very frequently while solving problems. Okay. So please make a note of this and do let me know in case of any concerns. Next one is equally likely. What are equally likely events? That is something, again, you get to hear many a times while solving problems. So we'll talk about that as well. But before that, please make a note of it. Right, Satyam. Absolutely right. We'll talk about that. So please allow me to drag the screen. Oh, I've only written here something. Okay, I'll write it on top here. Last is equally likely events. Equally likely events. So events E1, E2, etc. I mean, depends upon the question. Let's say if they are equally likely, are said to be equally likely. Okay. When their probabilities are all same, that means they have equal chances of occurring. Right? A simple example is, let's say the numbers on the die, they are all equally likely if it is a fair die. Assuming it's a fair die, okay? And for a biased die, it may change. For a biased die, numbers are not equally, these events are not equally likely. So you may have, let's say the die is heavier towards, you know, let's say a number six, then the opposite number will have a higher chance of occurring, right? So in that case, your chances of occurring of these events are not equally likely. Okay, so for equally likely events, they have equal probabilities of occurrence. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. Before I move on, I would also like to test you upon odd in favor of and odd against. Everybody knows this? Odds in favor of and odds against. Okay, you already know it. Okay, good. So if I say the odd in favor of an event or odds in favor of an event, in favor of an event is A is to B. Okay, what does it mean? It means probability of occurrence of E by probability of occurrence of E bar is A by B. Are you getting my point? That means odds against occurrence of an event. Occurrence of the event would be the reciprocal of it. That means it will be PE bar by PE. So this will become, as per the formula, B by A. Okay. Now, many people ask me this question, which I would like to ask you. If somebody gives you odds in favor of an event, what is the probability of that event? simple question. Who will write it down? If PE by PE complement or E bar is A by B, what is the X, what is the value for PE in terms of A and B? PE, you are writing in terms of PE only. Give me probability of an event in terms of only A and B. Your answer should only contain A and B, nothing else. Yes, come on, NPS Rajaji Nagar. I thought I would get the answer by this time. Am I audible to everybody? Sometimes it makes me doubt whether you can hear me. Yes, so please tell me the answer. See guys, I've already told you that PE bar is 1 minus PE. So this is A by B. Okay, so let's call, let PE be X. Oh, sorry, I wrote X inside only. Yeah, let PE be X. So basically you've written X by 1 minus X as A by B. Find X now, make X the subject of the formula. So BX is equal to A minus AX, bring it to one side. Okay, so X, which is nothing but PE, becomes A by A plus B, simple as that, right? So if somebody gives you the probability, if somebody gives you odds in favor of an event as ratio, some ratio or some fraction, please note that the probability of that event then becomes A by A plus B. Are you getting my point? Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? All right. Now, the main aspect of this chapter is, I'll come to that, but before we take some questions based on this. So let me begin with this question. In fact, it's a question having five subparts. Okay. I hope it is legible to everybody. So question says, discuss whether these events are equally likely, mutually exclusive, and exhaustive. So what they have done, they have given you the experiment. They have given you the events coming or events related to those experiments. You just have to say yes, no for each one of them. That means, do you think A and B are equally likely? You have to answer with a yes or a no. Do you think event A and B are mutually exclusive? You have to answer with a yes or a no. And do you think event A and B are exhaustive or collectively exhaustive? You have to answer this with a yes or a no. So let's say a typical answer for, let's say, you know, question number one could be like, yes, yes, no, something like that. So you please give me your response for only the first one in the chat box by writing Y, Y, N or whatever combination you feel. So you just have to tell yes, no for these three. So I you understood what is the way you have to respond. For example, the first one, you can answer something like this. No, no, no. I don't think so. They're equally likely. I don't think so. They're mutually exclusive. I don't think so. They're exhaustive. Got the point? So this is how you have to answer your question number one. Okay. In fact, all the questions. So I'm waiting for your response. By the way, let me erase this, else you'll think that question number one is already solved. No, it is not solved. I'm waiting for your response. Okay, Satyam. Please put the question number next to it so that, you know, it is not lost. So Vihan, okay, so Vihan has also answered. Okay, Harshita. Okay, Arya. Anybody else? Okay. Maybe let me solve the first one, then you'll get an idea. Only the first one, let's answer, Harshita, for the time being. Else I would lose track of your answer. So now let's say you're rolling a die. You're throwing a die, rolling a die, same thing. Okay. Die means, die and plural is dice. I hope everybody knows it. So when you roll a die, event A is getting an odd face. So odds are 1, 3, and 5, and getting a composite. Now, composite is 4 and 6 only. Right? So, non-prime numbers are composite numbers, isn't it? So, please do not include 2 because 2 is a prime number. Okay? So, you getting A has a probability of 3 by 6, which is 1 by 2. You getting B is a probability of 2 by 6, which is 1 by 3. Are they equally likely? No. So first answer is no. Are they mutually exclusive? Do you see any common element between A and B? No, right? So are they mutually exclusive? Yes. Are they exhaustive? That means that does the union of A and B make the entire sample space 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? You'll say no, because anyhow 2 will be missing in both of them. So the answer to the first one is Y and Y. Is it fine? Oh, Vishal has given all the answers. Wait, Vishal, you're too fast. Is it fine? So answer to the first one is NYN. Okay. So first one is done. Let's move on to the second one. A ball is drawn from an urn containing 2 white, 3 red, and 4 green. E1 is the event of getting a white ball. E2 is the event of getting a red ball. And E3 is the event of getting a green ball. Yes. Okay, Satyam. I think Harshita had already given one response. Okay, Harshita. Anybody else? Satyam, Harshita, and Vishal so far. Come on, guys. Easy. Okay. Are they equally likely? That means, are these balls present in equal amounts in these bag, in this urn? No, right? You have higher chances of getting a green ball, right? Then you have red ball. Then you have the least chance of you getting a white ball, right? So you getting, so let me just put a question number here. This is the first one. So you getting a white ball, the chances is 2 by 9. You getting a red ball, the chance is 3 by 9. And you getting a green ball, the chance is 4 by 9. Are they equally likely? They are not. So the answer to the first one is no. Okay. Are they mutually exclusive? Yes. So when you're drawing one ball only from the bag, it can either be white or a red or a green. It cannot be all of them simultaneously, right? So they are mutually exclusive. Okay, they are mutually exclusive. Are they exhaustive? Yes, they are exhaustive. Because there's only three possibilities. Either you get a green ball or a red ball or a white ball. There's no other third possibility. Okay. So the answer to the second part of the question is NYY. NYY. Satyam got it right. Vishal was wrong. Harshita was right. Arya was wrong. Okay. All right. Next one. Third one. Throwing a pair of dice. A is the event of getting a doublet or throwing a doublet. B is the event of throwing a total of 10 or more. I hope everybody knows a doublet. Doublet is basically when you get the same number on both the die or both the dice. 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 6, 6. These are all called doublets. Okay. So let's wait for the answer. Okay, Satyam. Should we discuss it? Okay. Doublet. Doublets are 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5. So let me call them as event A, which they have also called it 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, dot, dot, dot. Let me write them all. It's not many, just six of them. Okay, these are called doublets. Okay. Now, the probability of you getting a doublet is the total number of events in A by sample space. Sample space is 36. When you roll a pair of dice, you get 36 pairs of outcome. Out of which doublet are six of them. So probability of you getting a doublet is 1/6. Okay. The probability of you getting a sum of 10 or more. So 4, 6, 6, 4, 5, 5, 6, 5, 6, and 6, 6. Okay. So if you check here, this also is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 in number, right? So probability of occurrence of B will also be 6 by 36, which is 1 by 6. Yes, they are equally likely. They are equally likely. Okay. So the first one, the answer is yes, they are equally likely. Okay. But are they mutually exclusive? I don't think so, because 5-5 is occurring and 6-6 is occurring in both of them. So they have certain elements which are common to both these events. So A intersection B is not a null set. So if it is not a null set, they are not mutually exclusive. So this answer is N. Are they exhaustive? That means if you take the union of A and B, do you get all the 36 events that occur when you roll a pair of dice? You'll say no, sir. Not all of them are covered. So are they exhaustive? Answer is no. The answer for the third question becomes YNN. Very good. I can see Vihan, Harshita, all of them getting correct. But why only a handful of you are replying? I don't see, like, you know, people, I don't see any point for not replying for such easy questions. Okay. I could understand if the question becomes tougher. Okay. Next one. Let me just drag it up. Fourth one. I hope you can all see the question. Since I needed some space, I have just dragged it up. From a well-shuffled pack of cards, a card is drawn. So one card is drawn. So even is the event of getting a heart. E2 is event of getting a spade, diamond, and club. I hope all of you know the suits in a card. Okay. So there is a heart. Okay. There is a spade. So heart looks like this. Okay. Spade, I think it looks like this. Okay. Diamond looks like this. And club, I think it looks like this. Correct? Correct, Arya? Arya knows it very well. Arya? Every day she plays. Joker and all are not considered to be the part. There's no, and when you talk about 52 cards, Neil, in that we don't consider any Joker and all. Okay. So there are 13 cards of each type in a suit of cards. So 13 hearts are there, 13 spade, 13 diamonds, and 13 clubs. Okay. Now, are these events equally likely? That means, is it equally likely to get a heart, a spade, and a diamond, and a club? You'll say yes, sir, because each of these probabilities is going to be 1/4 each. Okay, so they are equally likely. Now, are they mutually exclusive? Yes, a card cannot be simultaneously a heart and a spade both. Okay, so the answer is yes for this as well. Okay, now, are they exhaustive? Yes. So when you're drawing a card, it has to be from one of these four suits. You cannot get a fifth type of card, right? So they are collectively exhaustive as well. So the answer to the fourth part is yes, yes, yes for all the three. Is it fine? Any questions? So I could see yes, yes, yes being given by Harshita, Tanvi, Satyam. Awesome. Great. Fifth one now. From a well-shuffled pack of cards, a card is drawn. Okay, A is getting a heart, B is getting a face card. By the way, all of you should be aware that there are three face cards, king, queen, and jack. These are called face cards. So every suit has got three face cards, king, queen, and jack. Okay. What do you call it in Hindi? I have heard some people playing cards in Hindi. They say Badshah, right? Badshah, Rani, and Gulam. Like that they say, isn't it? Am I right? Yeah. Okay, so the first part of the question is, getting a heart and getting a face card, are they equally likely? So remember, getting a heart, the probability is already 1/4. I'll write it once again. Getting a face card, please remember there are 3 face cards per suit. So there will be 12 face cards in all. So 12/52. I don't think so it is going to be 1/4 because 1/4, it needs 13. So are they equally likely? Illa. No. Right? They're not going to be equally likely. Okay. Okay, are they mutually exhaustive? Are they mutually exclusive? So there could be a face card which is a heart. Let's say king of hearts, queen of hearts, jack of hearts. Okay, so they're not mutually exclusive. So the answer for this is again a N. Are they collectively exhaustive? That means, is every card either a heart or a face card? No, there could be spade as well. There could be diamonds as well. There could be clubs as well. So this answer is no. So N for the third one. Excellent. Tanvi got it right. Many of you have got this right. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Oh, good that we revised our, suits of the cards as well. Should I move on? Okay. So the next thing is the use of permutations and combinations in evaluating the probability of an event. In finding P. Now, of course, I don't need to teach any theory over here because I'm assuming the prerequisites are already taken care of. You know your PNC, I know quite well. So better to start, using or solving questions where PNC knowledge may be required. Okay. So let's start with this question. Let's say this question. Now, give me a response on the chat box by putting the proper question number against it. Let's read the question together. A bag contains 8 red, 5 white walls. 3 walls are drawn at random. Find the probability that, let's say I am talking about the first question, all the 3 balls are white. All the 3 balls are white. Okay, now before you start solving the question, let me ask you one question. Do you think these all 8 red balls are identical? Or do you think all these 5 white balls are identical? What's your take on that? Do you think these are all 8 identical red balls and 5 identical white balls? Right, Satyam. So Satyam is absolutely right. Unless until specified, you will not take them to be identical. Okay. If they are identical, the question setter will specify that in the question. He will say there are 8 identical red balls. There are 5 identical white balls. So here is the take. Here is the rule that we follow. If not stated, it will be considered to be distinct. So these 8 balls will all be distinct from each other. Yes, here it will be distinct, Achintya. All these 5 white balls will be distinct from each other. Whether the distinction is caused by their difference in sizes or maybe by difference in their hue. So white also, a lot of hues are there, no? Creamy white, off white, whatever white, you know, sparkling white, dazzling white. So they are of different hues of white. Okay, now proceed. Okay, another thing I would like to, sorry to interrupt you. I wanted you to be very clear while you're solving the question. When they say 3 balls are drawn at random, what does it mean? Anybody can explain this to me in simple English? Three balls are drawn at random. Okay, now, Satyam, what I mean to say when I say, please explain to me, are they drawn one after the other, keeping, and I mean, let's say I draw the first ball. Okay. Then do I put it back and then draw the second one? And then I put it back and then draw the third one? Or is it like, I take one out, keep it with me. I take another out, I keep it with me. I take third one out and keep it with me. Does it mean that? Or does it mean like in one shot, I put my hand and draw all of these together? How am I doing it? Okay. So those who are saying drawing them all at once or drawing them all together, you are absolutely right. Okay. Now here is the distinction that you should all appreciate between the terms that we are using here. Sometimes you draw with replacement. Drawing with replacement. Okay, later on in the questions, you will see drawing with replacement. Sometimes you draw. Let me not write drawing. It appears to be as if I'm doing some sketch. Draw without replacement. Okay. And sometimes we draw together. Okay, or draw at once. At once. Okay. Now, please answer this question of mine. Drawing with replacement is very obvious. You draw a ball, you notice something about it. Maybe you notice its color, whatever you want to notice about it, and you put it back before you draw the next ball, isn't it? So that is called, let's say I'm drawing 2 balls with replacement. What is the meaning of that? You draw one ball, observe its color, size, whatever you want to do it, put it back. Then you draw another ball, okay? And do whatever required, okay? When you say I'm drawing 2 balls without replacement, what does it mean? I draw one ball, I notice the color, but I don't put it back in the bag. I keep it with me, I retain it. And then I draw the next ball, okay? Of course, the sample size now will vary for the second draw because one ball is already out. Okay. But what I want to ask from you, what is the difference between these two processes, drawing together and drawing without replacement? Is there any difference between them? Mathematically. What do you think? Are these two processes different or same? Mathematically, different or same? What do you think? Write on your chat box, write DIFF for different and SEME for same. I'll come to know whether your understanding is. I never say we are, I'm ordering the balls. I'm drawing the two balls, let's say, and I'm saying I'm drawing without replacement, and I'm saying I'm drawing them both together at once. Mathematically speaking, are these two ways of drawing the ball different from each other or same? Okay. So up till now, I have got just one person saying same. Okay. Now there are two people who are saying it is the same. Okay. Anybody else? See, it's just about knowing your opinion. Please don't refrain yourself from answering, thinking that, oh, what will sir think? Let it be wrong. I just want to know your opinion. Let's have an interactive session. Okay, anybody else? Okay, now the verdict of this is they're actually same. Okay, now see why it is same. When you're drawing two balls one by one without replacement, what are you doing? Let's say there are two balls A and B. How do I show? Maybe I don't have a small object with me. Maybe let's say I have these two pens with me, let's say. Okay. Let's say this two pens. Okay. I hope you can see these two pens. Okay. On the screen. So they're kept somewhere and I'm drawing one pen. I'm retaining it with myself and then I'm drawing another pen. Correct. Can I say when I'm drawing them together, it is like I pick one and within a fraction of a second, other one is picked. Thereby giving you a sense that they have been picked together. But mathematically speaking, when you're picking them together, there is a time lag of, let's say, infinitesimal between them. So it actually becomes picking without replacement. So mathematically speaking, drawing two balls together and drawing two balls with replacement does not make any difference to the answer. It is going to be the same process mathematically. Whether you say, sir, English wise, it is different, but mathematics doesn't distinguish between the two cases. Are you getting my point? So these two processes are actually the same process. Now, let me give you a live example. Let us say there is a bag. This bag contains three green balls and let's say two red balls. Okay. Now, let's say the question is, you are drawing two balls without replacement. What is the probability that one is a red and other is a green? Okay, so question is very simple. I'll give you two questions. You are draw two balls from the bag without replacement. Okay. Find the probability that one is red and other is green. See, what you did was you put your hand, you got a ball. Again, you put your hand, you got a ball. Ultimately, you should have a red and a green. Okay, so If you're drawing the balls from the bag without replacement, what is the probability for this? And the second case is, if you're drawing the two balls together, if you draw two balls together, okay, then what is the probability? Now here, if somebody tries to solve this question, he will get the same answer for both of them. See how? So if you want the two balls to be drawn without replacement, and at the end of the experiment, you want to see a red and a green in your hand. So it can either happen in this way. You ended up getting a red first and then a green, or a green first. Sorry, a red first and then a green, correct? So what is the answer coming out from this case? It is going to become 6 by 20 twice of 6 by 20, which if I'm not mistaken is going to be 3 by 5. Correct? Now, if you solve this question by using your idea of picking together, you want to pick one green out of 3 green and one red out of 2 red. Out of a total number of way is 5C2, because two balls from five distinct balls can be picked up in 5C2. So this is your favorable events. This is your number of sample space. So if you solve this, it becomes 3 × 2 / 5C2, which is 10, which is again a 3 by 5. So as you can see, the answer doesn't change because of the situation that one is drawn without replacement and the other one is drawn together. Okay. So mathematically speaking, these two cases, the last two cases are identical. They are not, are same things, not different things. Of course, drawing with replacement is a different thing. Okay. However, the same question, if I have to solve with replacement, how would you solve it? Okay. Now you're drawing two balls with replacement. With replacement. So if you're drawing two balls with replacement, you'll say, okay, I could either end up getting a green first and then a red, or a red first, then a green. In this case, your answer will become 2 × 6 / 25, which is 12 by 25. Drastically different from the other two answers. Is it fine? Okay. Now, I thought it would be good to actually know this concept beforehand only, else people do a lot of mistakes on these type of questions initially. Now, the actual question. Now, let me invite responses for the actual question. First one. All the three are white. What is the answer? Please give me your answer in a raw form. So 5C3, that's the favorable event. Total balls are 13 and you have to draw three out of them. So the first answer is 5C3 upon 13C3. Okay, I'm not interested in knowing the exact value, Satyam, but thank you for letting me know that. So the first answer is 5C3 divided by 13C3, what am I saying? Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Now here, many people ask me this question. Sir, if I solve this question from a very layman's perspective, so how would I solve this question? Very simple. You say, okay, the first ball should be white, whose chances is 5 by 13. Second ball should also be white, whose chances is 4 by 12, because the number of balls will be reduced. And third also is white, that chances is 3 by 11. Are you getting my point? If you check this and this, the answer would actually be the same. Let's try to do that. So let's try to figure out these two values. What is 13C3, by the way? 13 × 12 × 11 / 6, 286. So it is 10 by 286. Or to be precise, 5 by 143. And you can see that this answer will also be 5 by 143. So this is how a person who knows PNC will solve it. And this is how a person who knows basics of probability, he will solve it. Okay. Now, in this case, this approach seems to be okay-ish. But when you start talking about complicated cases, something like the third case, where one is red and the two are white, this approach will be lengthy. The second approach will be lengthy to solve it. So if I know PNC, I would prefer this. So I prefer this approach over this. Okay. Now you will also start preferring it once you start spending more time doing it in a very, you can say, basic way or very fundamental way. Okay. So second one answer is very, straightforward. 8C3. Yeah. 8C3 by 13C3. Okay. Or if you want to solve it in a more fundamental way, you will say, okay, 8 by 13, 7 by 12, 6 by 11, right? Both the answers will be the same. Now coming to the third one, here is something where you will learn why PNC is more important, why PNC method is preferred. So if you want to have one red and two white, right, 8C1, 5C2 by 13C3, straight away. But let's say somebody wants to do it in a very, very fundamental way. See how he will do this question. So I want one red and two white. So he will say, okay, there are following cases I can do. Red first, then white, white. White, red, white. White, white, red. Correct? And now this person will sit and evaluate each one of these cases separately and add them to get his answer. So let's do that and try to match our notes. So first getting a red is 8 by 13. Then getting a white is 5 by 12. Again, getting a white is 4 by 11. Okay. Now this case is over. This is first case. So second case, let's focus. White will be 5 by 13. Red will be 8 by 12. And again, white will be 4 by 11. Correct. Then white 5 by 13, 4 by 13, sorry, 4 by 12. And this will be red means 8 by 11. Okay. Now let's try to add these three and see what do we obtain. Let's add. So you can see here that the figures on the numerator will always be 8, 5, 4. And denominator will always be 13, 12, 11. And they will get multiplied with three times because you are writing them thrice. Isn't it? Okay. Now see here, everybody. If you evaluate it, what are you going to get? 8, let's try to cancel things out. This and this will get canceled with this by a factor of 2. So there will be 2 on the top. Okay. So it will be 40 by 143. Am I right? Am I missing out anything? Okay. So with so much of effort, you got 40 by 143 here. Let's try to check what happens over here. This is 8 into 10 by 13C3. 13C3 is 286. So cancel it out, 40 by 143. Okay, which now the verdict is quite loud and clear. The first method, this method, the one which I did it in white, this was much faster as compared to this. Yes or no? This was slightly slower. So the choice is yours, whether you want to stick to your basics or you want to start using PNC to solve your question. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns, anybody? Okay, great. Let's take the next question. Three integers are chosen at random from the first 20 integers. Find the probability that their product is even. Find the probability that their product is even. I'm launching the poll for answering this question. So please leave your response on the poll. Okay, almost 2 minutes gone. I could just get two responses so far. Okay, Achintya, Satyam, we will see. First 20 integers, I think they mean 1 to 20. Okay, they should have written it properly. First positive 20 integers. Okay, so we'll stop the poll in another 45 seconds. So those who want to answer, please do so in the next 45 seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, just 10 of you have responded, less than 50% of the class. Now let me ask somebody. Arnav Pai, which option have you gone for, Arnav? If at all you have solved it. Okay. Okay, Harshita. Okay, Arnav says A. But Arnav, most of the people have gone with option C. Okay, let's check. See, if you want the product to be even, at least one of these three numbers must be even. Let's say my numbers are A, B, and C. At least one of these three should be even, right? If you want the product to be even. So why don't we do this question in this way? So let me figure out the cases where the product will be odd. So if you want an odd product to come out, you must pick up A, B, C, all of them to be odd. Correct? So what is the number of ways in which I can get the product to be odd? Is the same way as you pick up the number of odd numbers out of 1 to 20. There are 10 odd numbers. So if you pick up any three of them, it will be odd. And sample space will be 20C3. So probability of you getting a product of odd will be 10C3 by 20C3. Am I right? So 20C3, let's calculate. This is going to be 120. 20C3 is 20 into 19 into 18 by 6. Okay. So if I'm not mistaken, this goes by a factor of 2. So 2 by 19. So can I say probability that the product will be even will be 1 minus the probability that the product will be odd because they are complementary events? So answer is 17 upon 19, which is option number C. So people who have said C, absolutely right. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Now, if you want, you can also solve this question by taking cases. That means, let's say exactly one of them is even. Two of them are odd, exactly two of them is even, one of them is odd, or all of them is even. If you add them all also, you will end up getting the total number of cases in which you get even product. But that's a longer way to solve the question. I believe that. Okay. Can we have the next question now? Okay. Let's take another one. Let's take this one, a simpler one, where maybe a lot of PNC is not required. A bit of Find the probability that the two-digit number formed by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is divisible by 4. Repetition of digit is allowed. I'm relaunching the poll. The way to solve any probability question is getting these two. What are the number of favorable events and what is the number of sample space? So find these two by using your knowledge of probability if needed. If needed, okay. I mean, not for all the questions you will need it. Okay. So Achintya, there is an option for that as well. I will not say which one, else people will get a... Yeah. Okay, so I have got two responses in little less than 2 minutes. Go on. You should always, Harshita, actually. A mistake which commonly people make is that they turn a blind eye towards the options, which is not actually good. Now, looking at the option and finding, looking at the option while reading the question is very much recommended. Many people believe in, okay, revelation. I solve it and I finally get, you know, explore which option is matching. So look at the options while solving the question. Okay, I can give 30 more seconds, not more than that. Okay, Satyam. All right, so 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Cool. Oh, I can see this time the response has gone slightly higher. 52% of you have voted. By the way, most of you have gone with option number D. None of these. Okay, let's check. So first of all, sample space would be total number of two-digit numbers that you can make by using these digits where repetition is allowed. So five ways to fill this, correct? So there are 25 such numbers, okay? Now, your favorable events are those events where your number happens to be a two-digit number divisible by 4. So what are the options? You can have a number like 12, correct? You can have a number like 21. Sorry, not 21, 24. Okay, you can have a number like 32, correct? You can have a number like 52, correct? Yes or no? Any number which I am missing out, 44, because repetition is allowed. Right? So altogether, the number of favorable events is only 5. So your probability of this event to occur is 5 by sample space, which is 25. Answer is 1 by 5, which is not there in your options other than none of these. So exactly option number D is the right answer. Well done. So did not require much of a PNC here, but yes, your counting skills is definitely needed. Is it fine? Any questions? Right. None of these is not one of the answers normally. That's why many people have this element of doubt. Okay, let's take another one. Let's take this question. Mr. A lives at origin on the Cartesian plane. So this is the house of Mr. A. Okay, this is the house. And his office is at 4,5. Okay, so this is the office of Mr. A. His friend lives in 2,3, which is already shown in the diagram. Mr. A can go to his office traveling one block at a time, either in the positive Y or positive X direction. Okay, very similar to what we had discussed the other day in the permutation combination topic. If all possible paths are equally likely, what is the probability that Mr. A passes by his friend's house while going to his office? Okay, so what is the chance that Mr. A will choose a path which is passing through his friend's house while going to his office? I'll put the poll on. Again, go by the basics. You need sample space. You need favorable events. So find both these out by using your PNC skills. Okay, I got one response so far. Oh, only 2 people responded. 2.5 minutes gone. I hope all of you are aware that the upper limit to solving any PNC question is just 3 or 4 minutes max to max. Because just a matter of click. Okay, Achidya. Okay, last 30 seconds and then we'll close this poll. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay, very few of you responded. I think only one third of the class responded. And those who responded, maximum janta said option B. Okay, let's see whether B is correct or not. See, first of all, what is the sample space? In how many ways can he travel from his home to his office? If you recall, I had basically explained this concept by trying to see this situation like you have four rights or four alphabets which are ours and five alphabets which are yous. Correct? See, if he has to go from his home to his office, he has to travel four units right. That means positive x direction and five units up. So the number of ways in which you can arrange these four identical R's and five identical U's among themselves will define how many paths he can take. So the number of paths that he can take will be 9 factorial by 4 factorial, 5 factorial. Okay, let's compute this. So 9 factorial by 4 factorial will give you 9 into 8 into 7 into 6 by 24. Okay, so this happens to give you 18 into 7. Let's write it as 18 into 7 as of now. We'll compute it a little later on if required. Okay, next. What is the favorable event? Now understand this fact. In order to know the favorable events, first he must go from his home to his friend's house. And from friend's house to his office. So how many ways can he go from O to F? Again, O to F, he has to take 2 rights and 3 ups. So can I say it will become 5 factorial by 2 factorial, 3 factorial? And means multiplication. From his friend's house to his office, he has to take 2 rights and 2 ups, which is nothing but 4 factorial by 2 factorial, 2 factorial. So this will become 10 into 6, that is 60. Okay. So now let us come back to our calculation of the probability. So it will be 60 by 18 into 7. I think this will go by a factor of 6. So that is nothing but 10 upon 21. Option number B is right. So Janta is absolutely right. B is the correct answer. Right? Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? If you have any questions, any queries with respect to any of the steps, please feel free to ask. Else we'll move on to the next one. Okay, let's move on to the next one. We'll come to this question a little later on. I think we'll take... C. since the response is slightly on a poorer side, I'm giving you an easy question so that everybody gets it. Let's take this one up. Poll is on. Question says, if the letters of the word assassin are written down in a row, what is the probability that no two S's occur together? Easy question based out of your basic understanding of permutation combination. I will not name the method because that will give you a hint. Okay, Satyam, I think you are the one you have answered on the poll as well. Okay. Okay. Two minutes gone. Only two people have responded. Okay, 5, 6. I can give 1 more minute maximum. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go. All right. I can see again, 7 of you are active and 5 of you say option C. Okay, let's check whether C is right or not. See here, again, the basic classical definition is of a probability of an event is number of favorable events by sample space. Okay. So first of all, what is the sample space? If you use all the letters of the word assassin and try to make a word out of it, how many such words can be created? As you can see, there are total 8 alphabets here. And out of those 8 alphabets, there are 2 A's which are repeated and there are 4 S's which are repeated. Am I right? Okay. So this is your sample space. Now, for your favorable events, you must have to count those cases where the 2 S's, no 2 S's are together. So here we will use gap method. Anybody speaking here? Neil, I think your mic is on. Yeah. So we'll be using gap method over here. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put the 2 A's, I and N. And as you can see here, within these alphabets, five gaps are created. Correct? So first of all, how many ways can I arrange AAIN? AAIN itself can be arranged in 4 factorial by 2 factorial because 2 of them are repeated. Recall your PNC concepts. And then you have to choose any 4 gaps out of these 5 to place the S's. In short, this becomes your favorable events. So as per the formula that I have used here, so let's write down. So probability of the event would be 4 factorial. In fact, this we can just write it down as 12 into 5 divided by this 8 factorial again 2 into 24. So let's try to simplify this. So 24, you can, in fact, 24 and 5 can go. And this will be 8 into 7 into 6. Okay. So this also can be removed by a factor of 4. This also can be removed by a factor of 2. 1 by 14 is the answer in this case, which is clearly option number C. Well done. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay, now for the last 20 minutes of our break time, we will, before we take a break, we'll take some complicated questions, the type of questions which normally is asked in JE exams. Okay. Sorry, if anybody had any questions. Oh, no problem, Neil. It happens. No need to apologize for that. It happens. Yeah. Next question is, read this question carefully, right? It's a question which requires you to be good with your PNC. Okay, Arshita. Okay, this question says 10 different books and 2 different pens are given to 3 boys so that each gets equal number of things. The probability that the same boy does not receive both the pens. Now, I'm just asking you to give it a try. I'm not very hopeful that you will definitely get it right, but just give it a try. Just see how you can solve this question. We will discuss this out. Meanwhile, the poll is on. I can give you around 4 minutes for this question. Think it out how to do it. It's not a rocket science, by the way. You can do it. Hint is just use your fundamentals of division of distinct objects into groups. If you feel there is no option correct, okay, then don't mark anything in the options. Okay. You give me the response in the chat box. If you feel there is no option correct. Okay, 3 minutes gone. No answers received so far. Yeah, sure. Take your time, Archita. If you want, I can give 1 minute from here on also. No issues. But something positive should come out from there. Some learning should happen. Yeah. Okay, Achintya, very good, excellent. Should we discuss it? I mean, I'm asking to those who are trying hard. Should we discuss it? Okay, so poll is of no use. I think only one person has responded, and that too on the chat box. Okay, so let's nullify the poll. See, same formula I'll begin with. Number of favorable event by sample space. Sample space is the total number of ways in which you can distribute 10 different books and 12 different pens, two different pens to three boys. So now 12 different items are there. You have to distribute it between three boys equally. Okay, that means 4, 4, 4. Okay. So it's an equal size group. Okay. And is the order important? Is the order important? Yes, because there are three different boys. Order is important. Why no, Harshita? Order is important. Because the same objects can change hands between the three boys, isn't it? So the number of ways to do this is 12 factorial by 4 factorial, 4 factorial, 4 factorial, and 3 factorial because they are equal size groups, and into 3 factorial because order is important. Okay. In short, these two will get cancelled and you will end up getting this as your sample space, number of elements in the sample space. Any doubt with this so far? No doubt. Okay. Now, E is our event where, let's say, the same boy does not get both the pens. So what I will do, I will come from a complementary angle. So let's say a particular boy, let's say a boy, a particular means already chosen one. So let's say a boy gets both the pens. Okay. So how many ways can it happen? So first of all, you'll say, let us select the boy who you want to give both the pens. So what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to find out the number of ways in which I can end up giving both the pens to a single guy or to a single boy, right? So first I need to select which boy I want to give both the pens. There are three boys, so I can select one out of those three. Am I right? Yes or no? And once I give him both the pens, remember I had to give him 4 items. 2 pens I already gave him. That means I now have to give him 2 books also. So you choose the two books out of 10 books which you want to give him. Yes or no? Right? So now four objects have already been given to this guy. How many objects remain? 8 objects. And now you have to give, now these 8 objects, you have to distribute between the remaining two guys as 4-4. So this is again a case of equal size group where order is important. So this will become 8 factorial by 4 factorial, 4 factorial, 2 factorial into 2 factorial, because these two guys can change hands, not the guy who has already been given those 2 pens and 2 books, right? He will not change his hand. That is already accounted for here. Okay. So that 3C1 is already accounted here. Okay. So this is going to become your answer to the number of ways in which a boy gets both the pens. So let us find out PE bar. PE bar will be NE bar by NS. Correct? In the sense that you will have 3C1 into 10C2 into 8 factorial by 4 factorial, 4 factorial divided by NS. Okay. A lot of terms will get cancelled. This definitely gets cancelled. Okay. And if I'm not mistaken, 3C1 is 3, 10C2 is 45. 8 factorial will get adjusted from here. It will become 12, 11, 10, 9. Okay. I think this will also get cancelled. 5. This will get cancelled. 2. Okay. Anything that I'm missing out, please immediately bring it to my notice. Oh, there's a 4 factorial on top also. Yeah. Thank you. This and this will also go. So can I say it gives you 3 by 11? Okay. So if PE complement is 3 by 11, what is PE then? You say PE is 1 minus PE complement, right, Achintya? And you are absolutely right. I think Achintya was the person who got it right. 8 by 11 is the answer. And that is why I said in the beginning, if you feel none of the options is correct, then please give me a response on the chat box. Because I knew if I'm going to change the question somewhere, you will understand that that option is the right option. That is why I did not write it. Is it fine? Any questions? So this was a good problem where we recalled our concept of division of distinct objects into groups. Anything here that is bothering you, you can ask me your concerns or doubts. Is it clear? This thing is clear. Why this? Why 3C1? Why 10C2? Why 8 factorial by 4 factorial? 4 factorial, 2 factorial into 2 factorial? Everything is clear in your mind? Okay. Great. Next. Okay, let's take this question. There are two vans, each having numbered seats, 3 in the front, 4 at the back. There are 3 girls and 9 boys to be seated in the vans. Find the probability that the 3 girls sitting together, the probability of 3 girls sitting together in a back row on adjacent seats. So you have to find what is the probability that these three girls sit together in the back row in the adjacent seats. Poll is on. Okay. So if you're wondering what are these two, these are headlamps. Headlights. So that you know this is the front. Now what's a headlight and not the other? No, headlight is important. How will you know it is the front or back? Very good. One person has dared to respond. Who is that braveheart? It's an easy question only. I don't get scared. Okay. So is this Satyajit, right? Okay, Satyajit. If you're good with your PNC, all these questions will appear easy. Don't worry. Okay, Arvind. Okay, Satyam. Yes, last 45 seconds I can give. Okay, Achinta. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2. 1. Go. Confused and lost. Okay, never mind, Harshita. I'll help you out. See, most of you have gone with option D. However, just 5 of you have voted. So less than 1/5 of the class. Now see here, again, let's go from our basics. Sample space is first thing that we'll focus on. So first of all, how many ways can you make 12 people sit in two vans having 14 seats. Tell me, at least this you tell me, I'm expecting answer from Harshita. Harshita, since you're saying you're confused a bit, tell me 12 people, 14 seats. How many ways can you make them sit? No, that you are only choosing the seats. On those chosen seats, you can shuffle, no, the people who have seated. So your confusion is in NPR and NCR. So that will go only with more practice. Okay. So this is your sample space. Now, what is your favorable event? Favorable event is those cases where the girls are made to sit on the back row of every bus and that too together. Okay. So now let's say these girls, of course, we all know that, you know, girls like to travel together because they will take selfie and all those stuff, right? Am I right? Harshita, you will do that? Of course, I know a lot of my friends who do that. Okay, so let's say these three girls, they choose van number one. Okay, first of all, they have to choose one of the vans because if they want to be seated together, they have to choose one of the vans. So two ways to choose the van, either van one or van two. Correct? Let's say they choose van number one. In van number one, they want to be seated in adjacent seats. So they can sit in the following way. They can either occupy 4, 5, 6 or 5, 6, 7. Yes or no? Then only three people can sit in adjacent way. So two ways they can sit in the adjacent seats. Now, having made the girls sit, the girls can intra-arrange in 3 factorial ways. Correct. Let's say 4, 5, 6 is occupied. G1, G2, G3. Then it could be G2, G1, G3, G3, G1, G2, like that, 6 ways. Now, remaining how many seats? How many seats remain now? If you check, 11 seats will remain. Out of 11 seats, you have to choose 9 and arrange the boys on that. So 11P9. So this is your favorable event. What is confusing and lost about this? So this is going to be 2 into 2 into 6 into 11P9. By the way, 11P9 will be 11 factorial by 2 factorial. 14P12 will be 14 factorial again 2 factorial. 2 factorial, 2 factorial will happily cancel out. And this is going to be 2 into 2 into 6. 11 factorial will get adjusted from here. This will go off. 7. 1 by 7 into 13, which is 1 by 91. No, it doesn't look easy. You have to break the event in your mind. You have to do it, you know, slowly. There's no direct formula. Most of you are searching for some direct way to solve it. Right, choose the van, choose the seats, make the girls sit, then the boys will sit. This is a way to, you know, crack the favorable event. Getting my point? This is all, you know, simple. Now, let me give you another question where the further testing will be, you know, done. One more question I will give you and then we'll go on to a break from there. Any questions anybody has? Okay, let's take this question. Okay, so before you start the question, let me make some small correction here. A and B are randomly chosen from this set with repetition. Okay, or with repetition allowed. With repetition allowed. Okay. That means A and B can be same numbers also. Find the probability that this expression AX to the power 4, BX cube, A plus 1 X square, BX plus 1 has positive values for all real values of X. That means this expression is always positive for all real values of X. Of course, those X's should be only from this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Poll is on. So the question setter has tried to mix probability along with quadratic or biquadratic, whatever you call it, inequality. Okay, so this is how amalgamation of concepts are done in competitive exams, because they don't have enough number of questions to test you on all the topics. So they mix two concepts in a problem. A beautiful example of that. What, sir? Beautiful for them, but for us it is hard. Okay, Satyajit. Put the poll on. Yeah, okay. Thank you. Okay, last 45 seconds. Okay, Harshita. So none of them is matching. Okay, fine. No problem. All right. So should we stop it now? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Cool. If you want to vote, please vote now. Okay. So just three people, three different responses, A, B, and C. Okay. Nobody went for D, by the way. See, first of all, favorable events, a sample space. You have to choose two numbers, A and B, from a collection of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 9 ways to choose this. And since repetition is allowed, 9 ways to choose this as well. So denominator will be either 81 or something which is a factor of 81. Okay. So there's a possibility of A, B, C, and D, all the four, as of now. Okay. Now, favorable events. Favorable events, I want to choose those values of AB, for which this expression is always positive. Okay, now let's do some analysis of this expression first of all. Okay, if I write it like this, I'm just breaking this term as x square plus ax square. Okay, I want this to be always positive. By the way, I can take an x square common from here. Okay. So x square plus 1 times ax square plus bx plus 1. Okay, this is always positive. Now this term is anyhow positive. That means if you want this term to be positive, that means this quadratic guy must be positive. Okay. Now all of you recall, when you're doing inequalities, and I told you a quadratic expression is positive, it can only happen in when two situations are met, when these two situations are met. Number one, A should be positive. And number two, the discriminant should be negative. Do you all recall this? You remember this? That means the quadratic graph must be opening upwards. Why it should be opening upwards? Because if it opens downwards, it will not remain positive for all values of x. Yes or no? Correct? And why should the discriminant be negative? Why should the discriminant be negative? Discriminant is negative because even if it opens upwards, it could open upward like this, cutting the x-axis. That means at some part it may become negative also. So it must be hanging up in the air like this, means no real root should be there. That is why both these conditions must be fulfilled. But now since A and B both are picked up from a set containing positive integers, this condition is anyhow met. Now I have to ensure that this condition, this fellow should be met. That means discriminant should be less than zero. Now let us go to the side of the page. If you want your discriminant to be, what is the discriminant in this case? B square minus 4. I think A is A, but C is 1, if I'm not mistaken. Yes or no? Yeah, C is 1 actually. So you want to choose those values of A and B for which this is negative. That means B square minus 4A should be negative. Are you getting my point? That means you want your B square to be lesser than 4A. Okay. Now let us take cases over here. Case 1. If I take B as 1, then what could be the possible options available for A? You'll say, sir, A can take anything from 1 to 9. Isn't it? Because if you put A as a 1, 1 square will be less than 4, 1 square will be less than 8, 1 square will be less than 12, da 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 da. So there are 9 possibilities coming from here if B is 1. Correct? Case 2, if you take B as a 2, then what are the possibilities with A? Can A be 1? Can A be 1? You'll say no, because 4 is less than 4 is not true. So A has to start from 2 to 9. So 2 to 9, there are 8 possibilities. Am I right? Anybody has any doubt in the second case? If B is 3, then this is already 9. So I cannot have A as 1. I cannot have A as 2. I can have A from 3 to 9. That means I have now 7 possibilities over here. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Count 7 will come. Correct. If B is 4, then this is already 16. So I cannot have 1, I cannot have 2, I cannot have 3, I cannot have even 4 also. So I have to have 5 onwards. Yes. So A can be 5 to 9. 5 to 9 total possibilities is 5. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Count on your fingertips. You can count it. Okay. If B is 5, then the left side is already 25. So A cannot be 1, A cannot be 2, A cannot be 3, A cannot be 4, A cannot be 5, A cannot be 6, A can be 7, 8, 9. So A can be from 7 to 9, which is only 3 possibilities. Okay. If B happens to be 6, that means this is already 36. So even if you take 9 as A value, yeah, so there is no such A for this. So for B as 6, nothing, zero case. Okay, B as 7 also, nothing, zero case. B as 8 also, nothing, zero case. B as 9 also, zero case. There is no A possible for these. Okay, so all these cases, I'm just writing them down for the sake of making a notes out of it. Yeah. So altogether, the total number of cases will be 9 plus 8, 17, 24. 29, 32. 32 cases will be favorable for us out of 81 cases, which we had already written over here, I believe. So your probability of this event will be, I'm writing it big, 32 by 81. 32 by 81 matches with option number C. So only one person got it right. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. So we'll take a break as of now. It's, I think, 6:26. We'll meet exactly at 6:41 p.m. after a 15 minutes of break. On the other side of the break, I will take up addition theorems on probability. Okay. See you on the other side of the break. So the next concept that we are going to discuss is your addition theorems of probability. Now, to be very frank, these theorems are almost, I would say exactly the same as what you learned in your cardinal property of sets. The only difference is instead of N, you will be using P now. Okay. I think you had a chance to see one of those addition theorems when I was explaining you the complementary events. So this is exactly the same as what you learned in your cardinal property of sets. Okay. So if you recall your cardinal property of sets, the first thing that you would have that we learned was NA union B is NA plus NB plus, minus NA intersection B. Okay. So A and B are two events which are basically coming out from, let's say, an experiment. So the same, cardinal property of sets, if you divide both sides of the equal to sign by the sample space, okay, the same thing takes the form of a probability. So this whole thing will now be called as probability of A union B. Okay, this whole thing will be called as PA. This whole thing will be called as PB. And this whole thing will be called as PA intersection B. Okay, so this becomes one of the addition theorems. Similarly, you can start making probability theorems or addition theorems from all the cardinal number properties that you have seen. Okay, so we can have another one like PA union B union C, like this. PA plus PB plus PC minus PA intersection B, B intersection C, C intersection A plus PA intersection B intersection C, right? So there's no difference in the cardinal number property formulae and the addition theorems in probability because you are just dividing throughout by the sample space and then your N by N, that is N of the event by N of the sample space will start becoming probabilities. Okay. Yes or no? All right. So let me ask you a few questions if you could remember. What is the probability of occurrence of A and not B? How would you write it? Of course, give me one of the representations. Right, it's PA minus PA intersection B. Okay, so recall your sets chapter. This was A, this was B. A intersection B complement is this zone, right? So now start thinking in terms of your sets. So this part is what? NA minus NA intersection B. Just start calling N as P now. That becomes your this thing. Yes or no? Similarly, what is your A complement intersection B? What is it? PB minus PA intersection B. Okay. If I say what is the probability of occurrence of exactly one of A and B, what will you do? Basically, you'll take the union of these two, right? So you'll say PA plus PB minus 2 PA intersection B. Okay. And not only these properties, just writing dot, dot, dot for it, depending upon what cases you get. You can also write inequality properties, which you have learned in your cardinal property. For example, Please note that probability of A union B will always be less than equal to 1. Okay. And probability of A or probability of B will always be lesser than equal to probability of A union B. Okay. And probability of A intersection B will always be lesser than equal to probability of A or probability of B. So these properties also will be equally valid. Just like you used to say, A union B will always be a subset of the universal set. In the same way, the synonymous form for that is your PA union B will always be lesser than or equal to 1, right? So I hope all these things, you know, make sense. So we will understand these through more and more problem solving. What is the meaning of exactly one of A and B? So let's say there are two events. You want exactly one of them to occur. So it will be either this zone or this zone. Here exactly one of them is occurring. Okay. So you can say it is PA union B minus PA intersection B also, which is going to result into the same expression. Right. Absolutely, Satyam. This zone is actually called A delta B. Symmetric difference. Perfect. You have recalled it exactly correctly. Okay. So let's see problems. From problems, we will learn more tricks of the trade. So let's get started with this question. Very simple one. A and B are two events such that PA union B is 3/4. PA intersection B is 1/4. PA complement is 2/3. First one, I would request you to write your response for the first one. Very good. First one is very simple. PA is nothing but 1 minus PA complement. That is the basic formula that arises from your complementary relation, which is again coming from your PA union B is PA plus PB minus PA intersection B concept. Okay. So this is nothing but 1 minus 2/3, which is 1/3. Absolutely right. Second one. Second one. Okay. So for the second one, we can use PA union B is PA plus PB minus PA intersection B. PA is 1/3. PB, I don't know so far. PA union B is 3/4. PA intersection B is minus 1/4. So from here, I can say PB is, take this 1/4 to the other side and subtract a 1/3. That's nothing but 2/3. Absolutely right. Third one. Yeah, so PA intersection B complement, as I already discussed with you, it's PA minus PA intersection B. PA is 1/3, PA intersection B is 1/4. So that becomes 1/12. Absolutely right. Next one. This is PB minus PA intersection B. PB is 2/3. Okay, so this is going to become 5/12. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns with any one of the four? Basic ones. I've just taken the basic ones. Seven by 12 for the last one. Why? Why should it be 7/12? No. Don't call it silly. Silly word is to be dropped. What did I say? I've been telling this again and again. Silly means you are giving yourself a soft corner. Okay, let's not be soft with these mistakes. Okay, so if you give yourself that excuse, you'll always keep making that mistake. Okay, next question. I will relaunch the poll for this. ABC are three events such that PA is 3/4. PA intersection B intersection C complement is 1/3. And PA complement intersection B intersection C complement is again 1/3. Find PB intersection C. Okay, let's do this. Anybody? See, take the help of the graph. The Venn diagram. The Venn diagram is going to make it very, very clear. So don't shy away from using a Venn diagram. Okay, so think as if this whole area is PB, which is given to you as 3/4. Okay. What is A intersection B? A intersection B is this part. Intersection with C complement, that this part is your A intersection B intersection C complement. Okay, let me write complement like this. Correct. What is A complement intersection B intersection C complement? So A complement intersection B. So A complement intersection B will be this part. Okay. This is your A complement intersection B. Okay. Now intersection C complement, that would do away with this part. Am I right? So this white region that you see, this white region is your A complement intersection B intersection C complement. Okay. Now, what are they asking us? They're asking us PB intersection C. B intersection C is this blue part. Right? Isn't it? Now, from this diagram, it is very obvious. By the way, I'm stopping the poll. Yeah, from this diagram, it is very obvious that these three are mutually exclusive and collectively making the set B. In other words, PB is nothing but P A intersection B intersection C complement. पी ए कॉम्प्लीमेंट इंटरसेक्शन बी इंटरसेक्शन सी कॉम्प्लीमेंट प्लस this. Now this is already 3/4. This is already 1/3. And I think this is also 1/3. And this is something which we need to find out. Correct? So this becomes 3/4 minus 2/3, which is nothing but I think 1/12. 1/12 is the answer. Any option which says 1/12? Option number A. Correct, Harshita. Absolutely right. So don't forget your Venn diagrams. They are going to be helpful here as well. Okay. Because everything is inspired from your idea of events. Events are nothing but sets. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns? Sorry about that. I meant to drag it. Yeah. Let's take a question here. Very beautiful question. Okay. A is a power set of a given set X containing n elements. Okay. A is a power set of a given set X containing n elements. P, Q, R are taken from A. Okay. If P, Q, R are disjoint sets, find the probability that P union Q union R is your set X. Find the probability that P union Q union R is your set X. Would you like me to run the poll for this? Okay, so I'm just launching the poll for the first question only. Only the first question you need to solve. Don't answer for anything else other than the first question. Any idea how to do this? I mean, anybody has a vague idea how to solve this question? If you want, I can help you with the first one so that you can, you know, solve the other two. Do you want me to help you with the first one? Or anybody wants to try out the first one? Nobody is replying. That means most of you are trying it out. Okay. Okay, so one of you have responded after 4.5 minutes. So it's better I should discuss the first question at least. I'll give you opportunity to solve 19 and 20. See, let us read this question very carefully. I think with this power set and all, they're trying to confuse you. They're just trying to say that from a set X, you are trying to construct three subsets. Okay, so these are subsets of X. Okay. So how can you make three subsets out of X such that they are disjoint in nature and at the same time their union gives you the complete set? Of course, it is not always possible that if you make three subsets, their union will be collectively exhaustive, isn't it? Okay. And they're mutually exclusive also. So how can you ensure that? Now let us try to understand a simple logic here. Let's say your capital X set has got these n elements. So as the question claims that there are n elements. So let's say these are your n elements. Okay. And now your subsets are like buckets. Okay. P, Q, R. Now you have to start picking an element and try to decide which bucket you are going to place this in. But remember, the only difference from actual scenario of putting into bucket is now here an element has a power to go in multiple buckets simultaneously. That means if you want it, it can go in P also, Q and Q also, right? Unlike we have it in our objects. If an object goes in one bucket, of course, you cannot make it go in some other bucket because there's only one such object. But here these elements have the power to replicate themselves and go into any number of buckets that they want. Okay. Now, just think from X1 point of view. How many options X1 has? Think carefully. Think carefully and then answer. How many options does X1 have? Just give me a second. So children, they will shout like anything. Three options only. Why? Why three options? थिंक अगेन, आर्या, सत्यम, सत्यजीत, anybody who can answer this part, how many option does this guy X1 has? Seven options. Okay, now Satyam has changed his answer to 8 options. Why 7 options? Arya? Okay, Satyam, why 2 to the power 3 minus 1? Exactly. So this can be put in any one of the three, or any two of the three, or all the three. So if you see, it has got 3 + 3 + 1, 7 options, my dear. Are you getting my point? Why I'm saying 7 options and why not 8 options is because when you're making a power set, that element is to be used. I mean, you cannot see, what are you doing? You are trying to create P, Q, and R from the power set of A. Right? Are you getting my point? So in our power set, you have all possible subsets of elements of X. It cannot happen that X is not participating at all in making a subset. If X were not put in any of the subsets, then of course there will be 8 options in this case, but here we have to have this X1, or we have to have all possible subsets by using all the elements of your set X, capital X. So this guy has got 7 options. This guy also has got 7 options, and this guy will also have 7 options. Altogether, your sample space will be 7 × 7 × 7, n number of times. That means 7 to the power n options will be there. Correct. Now, this is your sample space. What is your favorable event now? Let me write it below here. What is the favorable event now? Favorable event will be those events where a particular element goes only in one of the sets. Right? It cannot go in multiple sets because then it cannot be disjoint. So it either goes in P, or it goes in Q, or it goes in R. That means there are 3 possibilities. So now for favorable event, every element will have 3 possibilities. That means your answer will be 3 to the power n as the favorable events. So your probability of the event will be 3 to the power n by 7 to the power n, which is 3 by 7 to the power n. Option number C is correct. Now, does it give you a fair bit of an idea how to approach this question? Yes or no? Now, will you be able to now crack the 19th question? Nineteenth question says, P intersection Q intersection R contains just one element. Then the probability that P also contains just one element is. I'll put the poll on for this as well. Yes, only two people have responded so far. Okay, let's discuss this out. See, read the question carefully. By the way, three of you have said option number C. Let's check. If P intersection Q intersection R contains just one element, what is the probability that P also contains just one element? Okay, first let us ask ourselves, in this case, what is the sample space? In the sample space, there is one such element which is there in all the three sets, P, Q, and R, isn't it? Yes or no? Am I right? So in how many ways can you achieve this sample space? That means only one element is common to all the three sets. How will you do it? Now here, see, everybody please pay attention. First of all, you choose one of the elements which you want to put in all the sets. Let's say you chose X1, okay? And you put X1 in all the sets. Okay. Now, please understand here, you are distributing X2 to X1 in such a way that PQR are now disjoint. Now, we don't have to worry about them being collectively exhaustive, but they should be disjoint. So now tell me, how many options does X2 have? How many options does X2 have? How many options does X2 have? Okay, now X2 here will have, now listen to this. X2 here will have now four options. What are the four options? Either it can go to P, or it can go to Q, or it can go to R, or it could stay back in X, right? I need not use all the elements, right? So this guy will now have four options. X2 guy will have now four options. So let me make a fresh diagram over here so that you understand what I'm trying to say. So X1 is already used up. Okay, so this guy will now have four options, my dear. What are those four options? To go only in P, only in Q, only in R, or to not go in any one of the three. Correct? Because you want the remaining N minus one elements to be distributed in such a way that they don't have anything common other than X1 itself, which you have distributed to all of them. So likewise, all of these guys will have 4, 4, 4, 4 options each. That means 4 to the power n minus 1 options will be there. Am I right? Any questions, any concerns here? Do let me know. Okay. Now, what is the favorable event? Favorable event here is an event where P contains just one element. So P only contains X1. Okay. That means if I want to distribute X2 now, it should not go in P. It should either go in Q or R or stay back. That means one way, NC one way to choose that element which you are trying to send. Okay. And the remaining elements will have N minus one choices. Remaining N minus one element will have three choices. Sorry for that. Yes or no? What are those three choices? Three choices are, let me write it down. Okay. So you choose that element which you want to be common. Correct. And now let's say X1 is that element. This will have only three choices: to go in Q, or to go in R, or to not go in any one of them. So this will become your total number of, favorable events, which I've already written on the top. So your probability of this event will be NE by NS, which in this case will be 3/4 to the power of N minus one, which I feel is not there in the options. Or maybe they wanted to write this as 3/4 to the power N minus one, but they did not write it. So anyways, I don't blame you here because none of the options seem to be matching. Okay. Sometimes they forget to, type properly. So this is a typo error, I believe. But the logic is clear to everybody, right? Is the logic clear to everyone? Any questions, any concerns with the logic? Okay. 20th one, I would request you to try on your own as a homework. Okay. So don't worry. I'll be sharing this sheet with you. So you can always see what was the homework. Don't worry. Don't start copying it. In fact, we'll take one more question before we call it a day. Let's take another one. One second. Yeah. From a pack of 52 cards, face cards and tens are removed and kept aside. Then a card is drawn at random from the remaining cards. If A is the event that the card drawn is an ace, okay. H is the event that the card drawn is a heart. S is the event that the card drawn is a spade. Then which of the following holds? Then which of the following holds? I'll relaunch the poll. This is an easy question. You should all be able to do this. Ace is the number one card. I hope all of you have seen the pack of 52 cards. There is a king, queen, jack, and then there is an ace. Ace is the card whose number is one. We call it as ikka. This is a super easy question. You should be able to get this. Okay, I can give 30 more seconds. S is not the sample space here. S is the spade. See, they have mentioned it. Okay, so don't assume that S means sample space always. Okay, now given S is the event that the card drawn is a spade. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, let's stop this. Most of you have said, not most, I would say two of you have said A, one of you have said B, and other has voted for D. Okay. See, 52 cards, you remove the face cards. So there are three face cards and there are four tens, I think, correct? So how many cards you have removed altogether? 16 cards you removed, correct? So 3 into 4, and these are 4 tens. So altogether you removed 16 cards. So there'll be only 36 cards left, correct? Now the question is, A is the event that you are drawing an ace. Now remember, there are one ace in each. So 4 by 36. So 1/9 is the chance that you get an ace. Okay. What is the probability of you getting a heart? Now remember 36 cards, 9 will be heart, 9 will be spade, 9 will be club, and 9 will be diamond, isn't it? So you getting a heart is 1/9. Oh, sorry, 1/4. 9 by 36, 1/4. Okay. So now the question set us says 9PA, is it equal to 4PH? I think so, because 9 into 1/9 is 4 into 1/4. Yes, it is correct. So I would definitely mark option number A correct. Okay. Second part of the question, let's see why others are wrong. PS. PS is again 1/4. Is it 4 times PA intersection H? Now see, A intersection H means it should be ace of the spade. Sorry, ace of the heart. Okay. There's only one ace in the heart. So that is 1/36. Correct? So this is PAH. A intersection H means it should be ace also as well as heart also. So there's only one such card, which is ace as well as heart. So out of 36, one case is like this. Okay. So 4PA intersection H is 1/9. Does it match? Definitely not. So this doesn't match with PS. So this option is not right. Okay. Similarly, let us see why option C is wrong. 3PH is 3/4, and PA union S is PA plus PS minus PA intersection S as per our addition theorem formula, which we have seen. So A is 1/9, S is 1/4, and A intersection S will be again a 1/9. right? Ace of the spade, only one such case. Sorry, 1 by 36. Correct? So if you solve this, it basically becomes 13 minus 1 by 36, which is nothing but 12 by 3. 1 by 3. Okay. So the question says 3 by 4, is it equal to 1 by 3? Definitely not. This answer is not correct. And since one of the answer is right, none of these is also not correct. Is it clear? Any concerns over here? So keep practicing. I mean, this is a chapter where more and more practice makes you better, especially with respect to your PNC concepts. Okay. So I'll be not going any further because